And what we thought would be something like software, that's a little bit of history where I am. So I'm a contributor to open source software since like over 10 years now, being a user before that, quite some years. I'm an ETL developer, so ETL is Enlightenment developer, Enlightenment Foundation Libraries, used to drive the Enlightenment Window Manager. I'm a developer there, I'm the release manager. I'm also maintaining a small subsystem of the Linux kernel, which is the main driving part here why I'm actually working on this kind of driver and this kind of scenario, but I will come to that in a minute. And I'm also the team lead of the Center for Software Engineering. So, what I'm going to talk about today, first I will go into the problem statement, why I'm actually doing that, why I want to test something like that out, why it helped me in my personal development workflow. Then I talk a little bit of hardware selection I've been doing there. That is not comprehensive, so it doesn't mean I look at all the chips and everything. I have a really specific use case in mind, and if you have a different use case, it might be not the best solution for you. So I got the CMCP 2210 chip, and that's why I go a bit into the details there, what I'm going there, what the status is of this driver, and so on. And then I talk a little bit about not the hardware side, but the software testing side I'm doing, because I really wanted a rapid testing cycle so I can actually work on the driver, test it, don't crash my system, but still be fast as that can do it. Okay, so what problem did I actually try to solve here? So, as I said, I maintain a really small subsystem, the Linux kernel. It's 802.15.4, which is a so-called low pan, which is a standard for wireless communication, which doesn't have much bandwidth or anything, but it's low power, so it's quite interesting. So some people might know, if you know ZigBee, for example, the lower layers of that net is 5 layers, that's actually 15.4. And the typical transceiver for this kind of subsystem is really normally really simple ones. They most of the time come with an FDA interface for the data transmission and some extra DPL just for signaling like an IFQ or resetting the chip or maybe some out-of-band signaling. So it's really normally really simple devices, and drivers are normally like only a few hundred lines of code, maybe 1,000. I just got another graph from it this morning, and that was like 1,500 lines, but that was actually quite huge. So that is the area I'm working in, and I want to improve on that. Because what I did in the beginning, and I'm still doing sometimes, is to test these kind of devices, I hope they're not too Raspberry Pi. Just because it's so convenient to have it, I could use a different development workflow like that, but I just use the Pi normally because I had some of them lying around. But there have been quite a few drawbacks with that, at least in my personal workflow for that. Building a mainline kernel for Raspberry Pi is not that easy. Because if I need to be updated with all what's going on in Next, for example, so the networking subsystem, to make sure that all my stuff that I send a pull request out is actually replying cleanly and merging cleanly and so on. So I need to make sure that these things are actually building. And that's not always easy with Raspberry Pi. I had at least 3 or 4 times problems with the USB host controller on it, and that means that I haven't been able to actually get access to the device for a serial line or something. And it was always been painful to get it rebuilding and booting up. So, most of the time it worked, but there have been situations where I spent hours on just combining the Pi instead of the actual driver I'm working on. So that was a bit annoying for me. Then there's cross compilation. I don't really mind that much, but you always have to make sure, okay, you have the tool chain around, everything is set up correctly, and it is sometimes annoying if you want to debug things. But in general, cross compilation is not the problem I'm trying to solve here. Another thing that annoyed me a bit was the whole process of getting the kernel to the embedded port, back and forth, booting it, rebooting it, the whole test cycle was slow. I mean, you could do different things. I just copied it over with SCP and then restarted the machine that worked most of the time. You could go with NF and then TFTP booting the kernel and so on. There are a lot of solutions for that, but it always involves more time in what I will come on later, which I do just virtualization on x86, and that is always a bit bigger there. So that is the problem statement I have here. I was worried about that for a long time. I still keep going with the Raspberry Pi solution, but at some point I asked myself if I should really not look into something else to solve the problems I have. So the green solution I was thinking about was small ship, just really simple one, because I don't want to make it more complex than it already is. That would be just having exposing SPI and DPIO pins, so I can really hook up the wires from my transceivers to that, make it easy to then connect it over USB to either my workstation code or my laptop when I'm traveling. So another thing, when I looked around, I found a lot of these kind of solutions, but they always expose the SPI interface to user space, be it either over lit USB or SPI there, or just as an USB human interface device or something. That's good if you have a really specific use case and want to have like the logic for your driver or the sensor you're reading from or whatever inside your application. But what I wanted to do was to make sure that I can test, write, and debug kernel drivers. So all what I need is that this SPI master driver is actually exposed inside the kernel, and I can hook it up inside the kernel, and then everything can get tested and work to it. So that was the problem when I looked around first. And another thing was that I really wanted to have a quick turnaround on testing here without a chance on screwing up my own system. So just building a kernel that comes from NetMax and rebooting it on my main workstation, that's not a good idea, because it can really screw up your, whatever, maybe your file system. I mean, normally that doesn't happen, but I mean, I really want to avoid all those possibilities at least. What I don't want to have again was like, I want to avoid embedded board, I want to avoid cross-compilation, no mainline kernels, no user space library, no hit interface, all of these things. So I looked around, looked what kind of USB SPI bridge chips I was able to find. But as I said, I had a really specific use case in mind. So the last point you can see here, so if you have a use case that really goes to the limits of SPI, this chip might not be the best. Because what I've read and seen so far, it might not have the best SPI performance in general, and you always have to think about that if you bring it over USB, USB is getting pulled from the USB port controller on the device, so the whole interrupt handling and everything, there is a latency involved in that. And that might give you a worse bandwidth than you could normally have, for example. But at least for my specific use case, it was really good. It has an SPI interface, it has extra DPIO pins. It had to be a ship where the data sheet is available, because without it, I'm not really having any intention to help write the drive with it. There must be a sheet development board. Normally you get a normal evaluation board from the manufacturer or something, that's $70 or something. It's fair for me to buy that, but to have a bit more exposure to other people to do that, or even buy a couple of them, because you want to work off like different receivers to them to quickly switch devices and connect them over USB or something. I want to have something really cheap. Well, cheap, I defined here below 30 euro, but that's really arbitrary. It would be good if there would already be a driver and having some kind of storage like an EEPROM or something to store configuration would be handy as well. So when I looked around, I found like four devices. There are more. So as I said, that's not a complete research topic yet, but what I found, what I was looking for, I just stopped at some point. So the MPP 2210, there's a public data feed. There's no mainline driver. There's an asterisk there, because if I refer to that, that means there is a driver actually, but it's not doing what I actually looked for. It's a driver inside the kernel, detected as an human interface device over USB, and then you can use it from user space and talk to the SPI device attached to it. But that's not the solution I was looking for. But there was an out-of-field driver actually doing what I wanted to do. I come to that later. And there was a really cheap development board available for like 10 or 12 euros or something. So the other ones all had problems in some regard or another. So the Silicon Labs, there was no cheap development board available, at least I haven't been able to find one, and I was not really in the mood in doing another PCB design and getting manufactured and anything. So, the FPDI chips, I mean, they are well supported. There are cheap boards for that, but getting this one in a situation where the driver would do what I wanted would have been more complicated, because there was no out-of-field driver doing that. I mean, they have drivers for all kinds of scenarios, but certainly not for that. And then there's something from Cypress, and they have really, really cheap development boards. I think that was around like a few dollars or something. But I haven't been able to find the data sheet. I haven't been able to find a key driver or anything, so I really decided to not go with it, because I would invest more of my own resources in doing that. is happening for the MCP 2010. Already mentioned that it was cheap, it was cheap available. I found two drivers on GitHub for that. That was the one I was mostly working with so far, is the one from Daniel Santos, who progressed quite far by now, but sadly never made it to the main line. One of the parts could be because it's quite huge, it's like around 9,000 lines of code, and for such a simple device, there's quite a bit of infrastructure he added there. So he added debugging infrastructure, this interface, and ICPL interface, and there's like a lot of configuration options to make something like disable GPIO, disable SPI. It was really flexible, but also making it really complex without any need for it, at least in my personal case. So, when I started looking at the chip, the first thing I realized is that the Linux kernel already detects the USB ID and tries to assign it to the USB human interface device driver. That is already the kernel, which is a problem because I don't want to use it. So one thing you can do is having a UDEV rule to unbind the driver, make sure that it detects on your own. The other solution you can do is write into the EEPROM from the chip your own product and vendor ID, so that you can actually, either you have one of these, or you can find a project that offers you some of these or something, then you can go from there. And because it's stored in EEPROM, it doesn't mean it's even there after resets and everything. So that is actually the solution I want to go with, but I haven't done that yet. So what you need to do on the kernel side to get this all rolling is, in the normal USB probe and disconnect functions that are getting called when you put into the device, you need to make sure that you are setting up an SPI master device inside the kernel. So the basic steps you have to do here is you first have to go and allocate the master after struct, and then you have to register to the SPI subsystem. And once you have set all these things up, you somehow need to let the system know what kind of SPI device is attached to it. Because SPI is not a bus where probing happens or anything, so you don't know what's attached to it. You have to let the kernel know about it. There's the struct SPI board info, information the struct, that you can just put in all the information you need. And then you give that to SPI new device, call that, and then you have some matching of the mod ideas, and then the kernel detects the device, loads the driver, and tries to do the probing of the driver. So that is the basic step that I actually worked on already. But the configuration I mentioned already with the struct SPI board info, that is good for really static configuration, where you say, okay, I know exactly what I have here, I can put it into the code, compile the driver, and I'm done with that. That's okay if you don't change things often. But if you have a bit more scenario where you change either the SPI chips on the you connected to them, or have in general more flexible need for that, you really are thinking about what kind of configuration you're going to do there. So that is what I come to the next slide on provisioning. But then I mentioned here configuration. That is what kind of configuration I want to do either during runtime, or do I only want to configure the chip during loading and everything. So the biggest part of the driver from that incentive that is already there is about talking to the device, making it configurable during runtime, and actually you can fiddle all kind of bits there, and that makes it really, really complex. I mean, that might be good for some use cases, but for myself, that was really one of the things that getting me annoyed to go through all the code and understand it. And it also is a huge problem if you want to get this driver into mainline, because if you start having your own system interface or even introducing new IOCDLs or something, that will be part of the kernel ABI, and they are not really happy getting new ones. If you have a reason for that, that's fine to do, but I don't really have good reasons for that. So what I'm aiming for here is to rip all this out for now, and we have only a configuration during compile or loading or something without any running. So provisioning, I also start to mention that you need to have a way to get this information about the attached SPI device to the kernel, to let them know what's attached to them and make sure that the driver actually gets all the information. The board info is a good start if you're just want to get it hooked up and get the driver development working. So that's what I'm doing right now. And it's not so good if you want to be more flexible, if you want to avoid recompiles when you're attaching new devices. So what normally happens on embedded boards is that you have like, you know, device tree set up, say, okay, on this SPI board, this is chip select pin or whatever, this is IQ pin or something, you have this kind of device attached. And this is something that I think we should do in this driver as well, and most likely also store it in the EEPROM. So next time you're loading the driver, it's already configured and everything, gets attached correctly. But you need to find a way to write to the EEPROM and send the new DTS over. But I have also suggested this, so if anybody has a better idea how to do that, I'm all ears here. But that would be my current plan. Yeah, so the main idea for the book, I'm not there yet, but that definitely be one of the things I want to do, because I don't want to have this thing out of tree, because that would not really help me in my use case at all, because I wanted to test it against my mind. So as I said, 9.9 of code, that's kind of a problem, because it's a lot of code that we don't actually need to have, but we have right now. So one of the things is to make it way more simpler. So I started to removing some of the extra infrastructure this person added that is already present in the kernel, so I've replaced that. There's been a lot of checks for out of tree because you're building against different kernel versions and stuff like that. Yeah, so there's a lot of things to do. I also started separately writing a driver for the initial task from scratch to actually compare if it's easier to do that or go with the Dart and Daniel. I haven't even made my mind up yet what direction I should go with. So the last item here is that I not only wanted to have these devices attached to my laptop or my workstation, but I also wanted to have a really quick test and development cycle. So I used QEMO for that for a while, this USB pass through, but I always had the annoying part that you have your own interface or this image, you have to make sure that all the tools are installed. It's huge and it's sometimes annoying to get all the things synced up. So at some point I stumbled over Verkin, which is really a nice selection of just some tiny Python scripts that do nothing else besides going grabbing QEMO and KVM and make sure that you can actually boot a compiled kernel that's sitting on your disk and then using your normal host system in read-only mode, you can boot up the thing, and that really was helping me a lot. So the workflow I have here, I said I build a kernel, a non-modular kernel, just for the ease of it, I pass it to K-image. Then I give the, okay, so I say that's my home directory, take that one as a root. I take the UDAP image, give it to them, and just for my specific use case, I give it the USB product and vendor ID here from the host, and then the whole USB pass through gets into KVM, and the driver attached to them, you can use the whole device as if it would be attached to a machine. So, what do we have currently? So I decided for a board, I decided for the testing part of the software side, I decided for an actual board. The OTP driver is detecting the board. Right now I'm in the process of hooking up my own transceivers and getting them detected. So they're getting detected, but I'm not done yet in having it all set up in terms of getting the IRQ looping correctly and having it really exposed to my subsystem. That's what I'm working on, I hope. My hope was that I would be finished by now, but it didn't happen. So the next step would be to simplify the driver. Then I need to think about more about the provisioning solution I talked about. And the next thing, the last thing, would be to get it on. Okay. So that would be it from my side. I only have a few minutes left. So thanks to all of us. And questions? Microcontroller, and UCs are capable of funny enough, I actually did something like that a few years back, but that was in a custom design for so an Apple controller and an Apple 15 or 14 or something, all sitting together, and I designed an UP interface for that. So I did that, but I didn't want to go the whole way designing the board, setting it all up, and making sure for that. So I could have done the way that we have to look at my program for that, but I really wanted something off the shelf that I can just grab it. So that's the main solution. That was the main reason for that, because the investment of time and resources had to do be a bit more. So that's not a hard engineer. So that takes me long enough to get it all set up. And then you have to find a way to tell the people, manufacturing and so on. But the idea would work as well. Okay. Was there another question or? Okay, so thank you for your attention and good day.